those 8 weeks, starting with Boydie and Jan at the beginning about the evaluation of players and scouting players through obviously Andre and all the other guys are the entire staff been part of that, which we're really fortunate to have that kind of staff, and we really care about each other, and that's why we all wanted to be on the Zoom at one point and share with you guys and learn from you guys as well. So again, glad to be here tonight. Developing the right habits at a young age. Obviously, what we're going to talk about tonight is stuff that we do with the 6-7s, but we really believe that it's really applicable at a very young age. And quicker to get those good habits, better player they will be. And if you can see where it's blurry, play the game the right way. It's I put it blurry there because we hear that a lot about that team plays the game the right way, that player plays the game the right way, and we want to define with you guys what it means for the 6-7s. Obviously, there's more than one path. We can talk with other OHL team or NHL or other country, and for them, playing the right way will be a little bit different for them, which is okay. That's why there's not only one recipe. There's more than one recipe, but we're going to share with you what we think is the best recipe for us, the 6-7s. And that's why I wanted to introduce that developing at a young age, because we feel that faster you get those good habits, better player you're going to be. And we talk a lot about, and I have a son who's 13 years old. He's a minor bantam. So I'm at the rink a lot, just like you guys. So I see the same thing than you guys, same games, and same practices. And for me, we can improve that, obviously working all together. And that's why we're on Zoom tonight. And that's why we go to those conference. And like I was about to say, is developing those players individually and collectively with certain standards is crucial. If we talk about the four roles of a hockey player, the two offensive roles and the two defensive roles, we can do a lot only with those four roles and teach a lot in a go with novice with a 4-on-4 hockey game, just like a Bantam or Pee Wee, Adam, Major, Junior. We work the same way, guys, the same hockey game at the end of the day. So that'll be our topic tonight. I will, Okay. All right. I will just have to share my volume. I'm going to start with, little video, a 50 seconds clip there of Nick Nurse, Toronto Raptors, talking about his team.
And it's just this small little circle that we're trying to create. And I think you're right. We tell them we're going to do both. We're going to play both ends. If you want to get on the floor, you got to play both ends, and you got to play them hard, and you got to play them within our system. But we're going to allow these moments of creativity and freedom, et cetera, for you to do your thing. And I really encourage that. I really want those moments where they can do something, man. Show me something really cool, you know, and do something that surprises the other team or even surprises their own teammates. And that's a part of it. But also just like to conclude this little segment on saying this, very simple. We always talk about offense as creating space, right? Space, keep spacing, keep your spacing, get better spacing. When you're in, relocate to create more space. And defense is just the other end. Take away the space, make things look crowded. Get plug gaps, get in the way and make it look like you're going to, be a problem on defense. And it's a lot about spacing.
One thing I think that players and coaches and just people around sports, mistakes.
Give me a second here. Was it lagging a lot?
Yeah, a little bit, yeah.
Okay. Give me a second here. Try to improve that. So basically what Nick Nurse was saying, guys, is we want to work both sides of the ball for them. Obviously for us, it's both sides of the puck, but that offensively, we want to create space. We want to use that space, find those new spaces. And defensively, we want to clog and feel a little bit like if you're 10 guys on the floor. So that's what you want to create there. And basically that's what we're going to talk tonight. Give me a second here. Holy shit. All right.
Locate to new, to create more space, and defenses just the other end, take away the space, make things look crowded, get plug gaps, get in the way, and make it look like you're gonna be a problem on defense. And it's a lot about spacing.
Was it better?
Yeah, much better.
Excellent. All right, we're good for the rest. So now, since the beginning, guys, obviously, like we said, Boydie and Jan talked to you guys about the scouting part, and they bring players to us. And for us, this is the pyramid there of a player development. We have to make them work, and we'll have a little video about competitiveness right after. But it's really about the work ethic. For us, work ethic, attitude, and discipline are crucial. And that's the first stage. If you don't work, I know that Norm will talk to you guys regarding that, that's the foundation of our we'll say success. If we want to have success, we got to compete in every situation, every day, on and off the ice, to be honest with you. And during practices, for us, this is not important. This is crucial. That's where good foundation start, good habits starts. So competitiveness is key. And then we moved on to individual skills. You guys saw that with Evan from Next Gen. And that's where all the techniques and all that stuff, I won't repeat everything they said, but that's the second layer. The third one was with Normal the past 2 weeks about the team skills, the four pillars that you guys saw over the last 2 weeks. And then bring us to tonight's about the all good, the habits. We call that winning habits. That's how we call it. So when we talk about playing the right way, we mention the winning habits. And for us, we work a lot with the players about the habits. When we talk about the team skills, our four pillars that Normal presented, it's more between us. Obviously, we'll share the final result or how to do it with the players. But when we talk internally, the staff, we use the pillars, but we don't present them to the players necessarily that way. But as you guys will see, we present them to inside our habits. That's really it. Stick on the wall there, and players know the habits that needed to be in place in order to play for the 67s. And the fifth layer is the system that we won't touch. In a sense, that system for us, like you see, is the fifth layer. It's not the foundation, is the last one. So we truly believe that with our skills, team skills, and the right habits, and obviously, and the number one, the competitiveness, if we compete in every situation, in every battle, we're going to have success. So, and competing at school as well. So for us, it's everywhere. Like I mentioned, it's on and off the ice. Training with younger, at school, being respectful, having the right attitude, and being disciplined at our billets, school, It's all about good habits. So now tonight, obviously, we're going to talk about the right habits, the winning habits on the ice. And again, another video, it's about the competitiveness. It's from coach of Duke there, Ms. Lawson.
One thing I think that players and coaches and just people around sports mistake all the time is they mistake hard work and competitiveness. They think they're the same thing. Hard work and competitiveness. Hard work is, I give you a task, right? I give you constraints on set task. I say, you have to do this in this amount of time, with this much weight, with this much load, whatever it is, I give you these constraints and I force you to do it. And it's hard, right? It's hard. So I can force you to work hard just by what I ask you to do, right? And I'm not saying that in a mean way. I'm just saying that in general. Like you can force someone to work hard, right? You can't force someone to compete. You can't. There's nothing I can do to make you compete. And that's such an important distinction in sports. A lot of players at the end of a practice, at the end of a game, they'll talk to their parents, they'll talk to their teammates and be like, hey, V, did you work hard today? And you're like, yeah, coach, I worked hard today. That's good. But did you compete? So at the end of every session that we have, that's the question you're asking yourself. Did I compete today? Because that's different than working hard. It's different. Working hard is something that a lot of people do, right? Millions of people do every day. Billions of people do every day around the world. Billions of people work hard in whatever job they do. But not everybody is wired to compete. So I've talked to some of you and you say, coach, you know, what do you need from me? What do you want from me? Like, what's important to you? I want you to compete. Every day. Every day compete. Every conditioning session, every weight session, every basketball session. Doesn't mean you're gonna be perfect. Doesn't mean you're not gonna fail sometimes. But it's getting yourself that mindset when you walk out here every day. When we're about to start, you click in. Yo, I'm ready to compete. All right? So start thinking about that before you start, and then when you're done, be honest with yourself. Did I compete today?
All right. So before moving forward, us with the 6-7s, we talk a lot about that the work ethic is essential, and we can bring a player to work at 8 out of 10 in a sense that the other two, it comes from himself, all right? So we can, like in the video, and we truly believe in that. And obviously for us, it's important to create that safe environment where the player feel free to express himself, and that where we all, as a parent, we all want our kids to be surrounded with good people and well-treated, and that's the kind of environment we want to create. But again, 8 out of 10, but the rest, it's all on the player and obviously his teammates. So high standards coming from us, and obviously that's part of the culture, and the players have to buy in and they have to fit in that kind of culture. And that's why we have a great group here in Ottawa. But yeah, the rest is the compete level. We cannot force them to compete. To be honest with you, in our team, we have guys who compete really hard. And when they are your leaders, you have a strong group and you have a great team like we had the past couple of years. And we have guys like Jack Quinn and Marco Rossi who are real competitor. They bring your team to an higher level. But I'm going to be honest, in our team, we have guys that we have to be on them to work. It's just a part of any teams. You guys have that as well. It's one-third, and that's reality. But when your strong group, your leadership group is on the right side, that's where you have success. So it's all about the process. And for us, that means a lot. And that's why there's a big excellent result. Obviously, we all want to win. We all want to win. We want to win games. We want to win championship. We all agree with that. But on our day-to-day, we really focus on the process, the right habits and stuff like that. That's really important. So focusing on the task, stay even keel. And I'm going to share with you a little, not story, but that's reality. Since I've been working with Andre since 05. So we worked together in Rouen for 4 years. After we split up, I went to coach as an head coach in Drummond for 4 years. And we came back together in Colorado for two years. And now with the 6-7s in our fourth year this year, that we're having a lot of success this year again. But yeah, back in Rouen, we're younger, more energetic maybe, and less focusing on the process. We're result driven. And that was okay. And we had great teams. All right. But we couldn't sustain and winning and having a winning streak, let's say for 10, 12 games, because we're so result driven that if we were winning a big game on Friday, that was a tough go on the next day on the Saturday night. So we had tough time to sustain because we weren't even keel as a coach. So obviously our players, they weren't staying even keel. So they were really high after a win on Friday night. So it was tougher on Saturday. So we had a tough time to sustain and being consistent night in, night out. Versus here, obviously 15 years later, we have way more experience. We learned through the years and now we've been doing that. And to be honest with you, last year when we broke the record of, I think it was 16 wins in a row. We finished with 17 wins in a row during the season. At some point during Christmas, before Christmas and after Christmas. For us, that was only noise because we didn't know that we were about to beat a 67's record and all that stuff. It's only the newspapers and the radio and Twitter who told us that that we had to beat a record there because we just didn't know. We didn't focus on that. And that's noise around the team. That's what we want as a team, as an organization, where you want to create a good buzz around your team, which is awesome. People talk about your team and all that stuff, and they're proud of your team. And like I said, that's what you want to create. But internally, we don't talk about those things. It's really focusing on the process. We're focusing on how we have to behave today and how we have to execute today. So for us, it's day to day, live the moment. Simple as that. And that's in our room. Obviously on the left, it's the DNA values, but also you see, and the main focus for tonight is the part there. And I like to see our group sitting there all together. It's been a while. I haven't seen that. So almost a year now that picture was taken. That was, I think it was our last day together, March 12th, before we shut down. So if we focus on the part there, that means process and attitude reward talent. So for us, that's important to focus on the process and having the right attitude every day, like I said, in everything we do. And if we do so, the talent that we have will be rewarded. So that's our main focus. The players buy into that and we're really proud of that. We'll have two little segment here with Coach Saban from Alabama.
Coach, the process is the foundation of your program at Alabama. But where was the process born?
At Michigan State. You know, I always sort of coached the old-fashioned, you know, work hard, get the players to work hard, and then always emphasized what you have to do to win, but never really broke it down for the players. Now, a friend of mine who was a psychiatrist at Michigan State gave me some words of encouragement about breaking things down one play at a time, play every play like it has a history of life of its own, and play the next play. And that was sort of the start of really trying to break things down for players as to how you have to compete in a game so that you have a chance to be successful. Rather than focusing on the outcome, focus on the process of what you have to do in every play.
Of life around here, it's the way we play the game. It's the thought.
So that's really our mindset with the 67s, focusing on the process, not the outcome. And the next video, another short one, again, about Coach Saban. And you'll see there will be kind of a little fight during a game there. And that the competitiveness and their standards that they establish in their organization. And that speaks for itself, but that's the kind of attitude that you want to have.
Of life around here, it's the way we play the game. It's the thought process behind everything.
Star quarterback A.J. McCarron was involved in the one play that epitomizes just how deeply the process has been programmed into Alabama's players. Late in last year's blowout win over Notre Dame in the championship game, McCarron and his center Barrett Jones called different plays at the line of scrimmage, both insisting they were right. A bizarre shoving match ensued on national TV. Saban loved it.
The game's probably won. And they're still
42-14.
They're still trying to get it right, right, which to me is the kind of pride in performance that you want in the players.
Can you see the critics saying, come on, coach, just take a breath, relax, enjoy the
right.
moment?
I can see people saying that, but we're still coaching. We're trying to get them to do it right. I don't ever want the players to relax in a game.
That's the kind of attitude and the kind of mindset that we want to have as a team, to be honest with you. That will happen that during practices, we have some FU match and some, not fight, but let's say a little brawl of pushing and each other, because they don't want to give an inch to their teammates. And that's how you get better. They push themselves and they push their teammates, and they help their teammates to get better, simple as that. And everything starts during practices, like I said. And like you was mentioning, you got to learn to break down your way, your habits and all that stuff. So in order to have good results, you need to know why you have good results. So you got to break down everything. And that's what we're going to do tonight. We're going to share with you how we break it down to our players in order for everyone to speak the same language. Even if the coaching staff, example, I'm coaching a new team tomorrow, Pee-wee B, I will make sure that with my staff that we're on the same page about the language, about our habits, about our values, and we'll share that with our players, making sure that we're all on the same page. So that's exactly what we do with our team on a day-to-day. So we really value our habits. That's how we teach, guys. That's with our habits that we teach. We teach a system, yes, a little bit. But if I had to put a percentage, I would say that we normally do probably 75 to 80% of our video is based on our habits. And the rest, when I say video, it's collectively and individually. And the last 20% is on the system. And for us, it really helps the coaching staff to evaluate the team performance. It breaks it down. And even if when you're behind a bench, let's say, and you feel that your team is on top of the game, and why are we playing well? But, and also why are we struggling right now? We're always focusing on our habits and our competitiveness. That's like I mentioned, that's our foundation. It helps also coaches to evaluate players' performance. And so that's really essential for us to share that with the players, how we feel and how they feel. It helps the players to get more consistency in their game as well, because of their focusing on the task, what they have to do, and working on the habits. It's easier for them to evaluate, did I have a good game? Yes, I had a good game because I was on the task. I was doing all the habits that the team is asking. So it's not about goals. It's not about assists. It's about the way to play. Help my team to play well. And if we play well, we have more chance to win. So for us, we value that a lot. And our day-to-day video, like I mentioned, is built around that. Here we go. Winning habits. It's playing the game the right way. And obviously, everything that we taught today, it's all about a decision. It doesn't need talent. Everything we're going to share with you tonight, it's not about talent. It's about the work ethic, the competitiveness, all right? And every single player, they decide if they do it well or not. And like you see, guys, we break it down in two categories. The first one is competing, and the second one is being a good teammate. So we have 15 of those, and we'll go through those with some video. The video will go quick. And like I said, if you have any question at the end, Like had, Jeff said, if you have any question at the end, don't hesitate. So we'll go with the first one, winning a race. And like I said, the first bunch are all about competing. So it doesn't need talent. It's all about your guts. So high competitive level, it takes pride winning pucks. So all the 50-50 battle, you want to win those races. We talk about position over possession. So it's positioning yourself between the puck and the opponent. So from a 50-50, let's say, I want to make sure that it becomes 100% my puck. So I'll get that position before trying to get the possession of the puck. And so just to help to visualize it, like I said, I'm going to cut the ends of the opponent. It becomes 100% my puck instead of staying a 50-50 all the way. And now hoping that it's going to be my puck. And at the end of the day, he picks puck at me and he leaves with the puck. The first three steps are really crucial. Like I just mentioned, cutting their ends. So get my hips in their hands. That's really important. And we have ways as well. Counter hit, stick your ass out, stuff that you're going to see. So here's some video. Here, right there. Quinter, number 22 against 15. There's a race right there. That's exactly a 50-50. And that's something that we work a lot during practices. We place a puck exactly there where it is. And we have guys at the hash mark. That's exactly our drill right there. We call that the pork shop. And now it's going to be 50-50. It's all about competing. All about competing. Now Quinter won the race and he established position over possession. And then after he'll possess the puck and we'll retrieve the puck and we're going to break it out. Next one. Oh, give me a second. I'll take the volume off because now I'm done with the extra video. All right. 50-50, number 28 wanted, Nikita, and is attacking the space after. Here, winning the race, replays the puck. If you look here, Olshey, number 17, he places the puck behind, he chips for Quinter, and then he wins the race to the net. That's another way to win the race. Boom, another scenario. But we want to win those races. Here will be between Keys, number 9, left winger against that D, face off. It's a 50-50 right there. That's the first 50. Normally in a game, that's the first 50-50 of your game, all right? Face off, boom. So we got to be ready to jump and help our centerman and ready to react if we lose it. Boom, 50-50, we win the race, win possession. It's all about competing. Here, Keats again, number 9, he's way behind, but he's going to win that race and get see exactly what we're talking about. That 50-50 becomes 100% now my puck. So get it, establishing my position before possession. So he's established his position. He's going to retrieve the puck. Boom, move the puck. We have the puck. Again, same thing. Win the race. Shoulder in. Boom, cut his hands. Hip in his hands. Establish good position. Create offense. The second one is winning battles. High compete level, hard in battles. Like I said, position over possession, key. Have the inside, hip and stick. All right, you're going to see what I mean by that. And if I don't answer well, talking well about that, just ask me at the end. And two hands on your stick in your battle. What we mean by that, guys, is when we're in coverage, defensively, angling, coverage in our zone, wherever on the ice we're in coverage, we're one end because we want to cover as much space as possible. We want to have a long stick, so it's one end on our stick. But as soon we're competing in a battle, it's two ends on our sticks. That's what we preach. First clip here, I have some NHL clips as well. The first one here, it's Montreal will win the battle. One of the rare ones, they won that game. That was last Saturday against Toronto. Toronto dominated them. But this one here, good forecheck. finish his hit, boom, win the battle. The next one, I really love it. You're gonna see defenseman number 22 retrieves the puck. Maybe he should have moved the puck before. That will happen. We'll talk to him, but now he holds on puck, but now it's all about competing on both sides. 71 and 22, they compete hard, but 22 won't lose that battle. He controls his edges there. Boom, get the puck, move the puck. Right here, Gallagher will win the race, so he should have the puck, but he doesn't protect his hands. So when we talk about possession over possession, here is going to be get pickpocket right there. He keeps that puck available. Marner picks pocket him. You lose that battle. So for us, that would be a teaching, an individual teaching clip there with Galley, making sure possession over possession, protect your hands there in your battle. And you're going to see after Gallagher doing a great job on the same clip. Gets the puck here. Now he's around the puck. He lost his edge a little bit here, but retrieve, battle hard, win the battle, and they're out. The next one, you guys talk, you saw that with Normal last week or 2 weeks ago, but we're going to go over it really quickly with a lot of clips. I won't stop them, but creating your space, but also I add there when we talk about the winning habits, attacking space as well. So all the counter hit, ass out, all stuff like this that you saw with Normal. But again, the competitiveness, the willingness, cutting ends, that's key to create your space. And now to attack that space, you got to detect that space. You got to be at on swivel before having the puck, if you can. If you don't, make those three steps, man. Those three steps where, I don't know, but you got to make those three steps. So you got to attack that space. It's right away. And that's it. That's exactly, guys, what we say to our players. I didn't know where to go. You got to go. You got to go. So they're going to take the habit of looking over their shoulder before getting to the battle or getting to, example, if I'm a winger, before receiving the pressure or the pass, I'll know exactly where the pressure comes from, but also where's my space and what are my options. So head on swivel, take a good picture of the scenario before having the puck, but also when you have it, scanning the ice all the time, that's key. So having an head up at all time. The first step inside, what do we mean by that is, towards the inside, towards the small ice. Attack those dots. Attack those dots, and that's everywhere on the ice. As soon as we get the puck, we want to attack those dots. If they give us the medal, we're going to take it because the game of hockey is a war of the medal. Offensively, we want to take that medal, and defensively, we want to control the medal and deny the medal. When I'm coaching young guys, for example, when my son was a novice, Adam Peewee, and example, coaching them at spring time, I was using the medal as the highway, saying that's the fastest route to attack the open net. So the opponent net. So we were saying attack the highway, attack the highway. So we don't use that at the major junior level, but with young kids, I thought it was a good visual. And I was using the outside of the dots as a side road. So it's slower, but you'll get there. So depending on what you're giving you, just when you want to meet grandma and grandpa, sometimes you can take the highway, sometimes it's blocked, so you got to take the side road, but it is what it is. You're going to get there anyway, but it's just going to be a little bit longer, but still you're going to attack that space. You got to attack that space. And defensively, we were saying that we're controlling the highway, so we're the cops. So we're sending them outside, outside, outside. So a little visual for the young kids. And like I said earlier, we're not using that at major junior level. Less dick as possible. So you want to tag that space. And that's something that is key. Every clip that you're going to see, or almost most of them, there's no deek. The player's attacking the space. And that's something that at a young age, guys, you have to educate your players to attack the space. Not everyone, but a lot of kids, what they do when they attack off the rush, let's say, they're going to go straight at the D and try to deke him instead of faking in front of him and attacking the space. And for us, there's a huge difference. And that's something that we can teach at a really young age to detect those space as a puck carrier, but also as a non-carrier to create your two-on-ones like you saw the last couple of weeks. But we're going to talk about it later on. And respect and attack the negative space. I'm going to come back with that. but that means a negative space. So here we go. Create your space. Boom. Right here. Create your space. Boom. Obviously, Adam, you cannot do that, but you would have cut in his hands. Right here. Create your space. Bang. Ass out from baller there. I'm going to play it again. Right here. Possession over possession. Right there. Surround that puck. With the D's, I talk a lot about surrounding the puck on breakouts, everywhere on the ice, surround the puck, surround the puck. So now it's 100% number 88 baller, Spock, and that's why we talk about possession over possession. And then we possess the puck, and great counter hit there. Good ass out. That helps to beat 232 pounds as well. Eric Winner, cut the ends. Right there, counter hit. Cut his hands, create a space, and after, attack that space. Great job. See the separation that he created between him and the defender? All because he took his momentum away. He took the defender energy and took it and suck his energy out and took advantage of that. Another one behind the net. Here, when we talk about creating space, I'll play it again. Right here, watch Quinner, number 22, right by the net. He's creating his space, right there along the wall. And that's something as well, guys, that we have to teach. We at a young age, we often teach, and they have their, I will say their ass, their back, that's better, their back on the wall there. So now you're trapped. For the defender, it's way easier because you're exposing your puck instead of surrounding that puck. Now Quinner's created separation between him and the board, so he keeps his space in front of him. So now on the cycle down low, we always want our cycling to go behind the net, by the way, never in the corner, because it's easy, but that's another topic. But we always want our cycling behind the net. So watch here, Quinner will surround, boom, lift the stick of the D, keep him behind him, creating his space, and now attack that space. This one, that was a quick one. Watch in front of the net, number 23, creating a space. That's against our former 6'7", Huddy Wilson. But watch here, push off, boom. That's almost a cross check, you'll say. I agree with you, that could have been a penalty. You have to be more clever than that. But the principle is there that we call that push off. You surprise the D and you create your own space. You're attacking the space and cutting ends. Whoop. Cody Clark here, 71. See, he's attacking the space, but also cutting the ends of number 7. So he's creating that separation again. Position yourself, surround that puck. And he's using the net, so now it's tougher for the D. So he's creating his own space. Okay, now I don't like what I see there. Change direction, boom. Again, cut, see his knee, get inside, get those hips on his ends. And use the net again, whoop, create a big separation. And unfortunately, he didn't move the puck to D. As a D coach, I would have loved that he moved it to D. Number 24 here, attacking the space. Head on swivel, you see the pressure coming in from the inside. Good edge work, something that we work as an individual skills. Now, team skills and habits, attacking space. We talk a lot about that. 16 now again, cutting ends, attacking the space, boom. Cut his ends, tag that space, change direction. Cut his ends, use the D, great job. Like we said, we want everything behind the net. Here, tougher. Our boards are square in Ottawa. It's tough to get behind. And to be honest with you guys, we're looking at the new strategy to work with that with our team. So as a staff, we're always looking to get better, and we're working a strategy we don't want to lose the behind of the net because we use it well. But when we get as an F1 eye like this, it's tough to get it behind the net. So we're looking at solutions. We already have solutions, but that I won't share tonight, but we have solution for that, but that's, when we talk about getting better every day and as a staff, be on details and getting better, that's what we're doing right now. We apparently had time over the last 320 days. So that puck end up in a corner, but here, Marco, good edge work, cut ends, attack the space, great job. Here for the D's, a little fake to create a space. Boom, fake, shoulder fake there, create a space, boom, attacking that space. Now using the net, that's a key there to create your space, and now he's gonna attack that space. And like we said, we love to attack the metal, the inside dots there, step inside, that creates chaos, and now we can play on both sides. We can play with the width of the ice, we can go on our back end or forehand, depending on the situation. But like I said, we can use the width of the ice way better like this. So way tougher to defend, less predictable offensively. But now they're going to protect the metal. 16 is protecting the metal. No problem. We're going to kick it out and we're going to attack that space. Again, now we talk about, I think you guys saw those clips, but I always love to share with you guys if we have new members tonight about the individual skill, that next gen work with our players. And we introduce that to our practice as well. So when we have practice drills, we implement that. And here you're gonna see, I'm gonna start it again. All right, the defenseman using the jab step, but that's all individual skill, bringing to our team skills towards our winning habits. Another one here, same thing, jab step. And after, we want to attack that space and we want to take the medal at ASAP. Here will be a 10-2. Boom, little 10-2. Boom, attack the space. Let's go. We're gone. Let's take the medal. Here will be more an in tight. So I'm going to surround the puck first. In tight situation, we call it. In tight situation, I always ask RDs to grab the stick of the opponent ASAP. So take the stick away. So now you cannot touch the puck. I'm surrounding the puck, so I have an edge. And by, in an in-tight situation like this, I'm going to get close to that. I have to feel my opponent, get close to him. So I'm going to take his energy out. And now I know where I'm going. Because he's behind me here, I know I can go on the left side, on the right side there. So attacking the space again. And now when we talk about cutting ends and attacking the space of the net right there, hips, cut the ends, attack, boom, score. Another one right here, Graham Clark, cutting the ends, attacking inside. When we talk about stepping inside, that's part of that, step inside. By changing the angle, 5 feet, change everything for the angle of the goalie and for the angle of the shooter. Now creating separation, attacking the space, good crossover, attacking the space, simple, boom, we're in the ozone play. Another one here from 24, when we talk about creating separation on the rush, on this one, he won't take the medal, all right, but watch his feet. He's gonna crossover, all right, he's gonna be delusive, tough for the D, he's gonna create that space, and then he's gonna delay. By crossing over, he's creating that space. Now delay, boom, create that space again. And I'm sure you guys saw, and to be honest with you, I cut it, but I forgot to put it on the video. I'm sure you guys, a lot of people saw Nathan Mäkinen's goal at the classic there at Lake Tahoe. So the crossover there were unbelievable. Here, when I told you about the negative space, that's the space behind the D. All right. So here the D has a good gap. We got the owner that. So we got to make sure that we play the game. We play with pace. We don't want to turn it over there. So you got to place it for yourself in order to attack that negative space behind that D. That's tough to play against. On that clip, that won't happen. And guess what? Turnover, you play against the best team in the NHL, 5 whites in the frame, they all came back, they reload hard, they came back hard, and they build their momentum together, and now they attack the metal, kick it out, attacking the space. Step inside from 18, create, attack the space as a non-carrier, F2, and the third guy, F3 on the weak side, they're attacking and creating seams. That's creating two-on-ones right there. So on that same clip, we saw the negative space, but also attacking the middle and attacking wide. If they don't give us the middle, we're gonna attack wide, but also non-carriers and step inside, but also non-carriers attacking free space and creating seams. And now the whites have the puck in the ozone play, 200 feet away from their net. That's tough to play against. Now, another 1 second quick, create two-on-ones. You guys saw that last week as well, creating two-on-ones. So we're to support a 50-50. You're gonna see what means that a second quick means. It's from 50-50. Support the puck carrier closely, create on-man situation against the defender, like we just saw, creating two-on-ones on the entry there. That's a good visual. Open the ice for the puck carrier, take sticks away, create seams, and have an open blade. So you guys will see a lot of right there. Second quick, that's a race between our second guy and number 21 right there. We win the second quick, boom. The job of the first guy is to separate the puck from the player. Second quick will retrieve the puck. Boom. We call that second quick. So really key in our game. You're going to see here, that's on a breakout. Good head on swivel from 12. He sees the support. We create a second quick right there. Boom. Second quick. We attack the middle. Kick. Step inside now from number 25, as you can see. Everything's a chain connector, guys. Our language, we always repeat the same thing. Here, 26, 11 was the first guy, 26 the second quick, right there. Boom, retrieve the puck. Ozone scoring chance because of a good second quick. Hold our ice, puck behind the net, create our space. Oop, we lose possession. That will happen there. Now, 23 is stopping on puck. 9 is coming. Hit. Second quick from 23. Ozone play. No brainer. Boom to D2. Good job. Right here, 21 will be the second quick. Bang. We got the puck first. We get there first as a second quick. We keep that puck. That's team cohesion. But as you can see, since the beginning, we're not talking about system, and it's applicable at every level. Every level, we got to work at those things. Now it's on N3, creating two-on-ones. Right there, Quinter in the middle, number 22. Boom, create his two-on-one. Step inside from 19 as well. Win the race, like we said earlier, between 58 and 19, that's exactly it. Win the race. We win the race inside. Boom, score. Step inside. That one lagged a little bit, but you got the principle there. We get the puck. We step inside. We take the metal, attack that blue dot. We always want to attack that blue dot. The face off dot in the metal, the blue dot, we call that like this. Obviously, it's pretty simple, but we want to attack the blue dot. Now we have option on left and right. We go to right, create two-on-one, create seams, boom. Create another two-on-one, shot, good scoring chance. Again, create two-on-ones, create two-on-ones. Play fast, attack that space. As a puck carrier, non-carrier, we want to attack that space and we want to move our feet. Too many guys, as a puck carrier, when they get to the red line towards the blue, they stop skating and they glide. Us, we put emphasis on that to attack the space, and F2 and F3 will adjust on you. But also sometimes you might stop at the blue and cut. We call that driving cut, which is okay. But have the tendency, the principle of attacking that space with speed. So now again, creating two-on-ones and taking the stick away. He tried to take the stick away, but the D went stick on puck, so he couldn't. As you saw, number 24 right there, he tried to reach the stick, to take the stick away, to create some space for his teammate right there. But like I said, the D went away, but create two-on-one, great job. Two-on-one, bang. Second wave from the D. Attack inside, 2-on-1, give and go. Bang. Attack with speed, he give us the middle, we're gonna take that middle. Step inside, all right. Drop and cut, cut and drop, sorry. We cut and we drop it. When our guy is late, that's okay. We're still creating 2-on-1 on that D. 2-on-1, boom, boom. Goalie presence. A lot of team will talk about net presence. For us, it's goalie presence. Huge difference for us. Net presence, you can be around the net and you're there. It's net presence. For us, we want to take the goalie's eyes away. So it's goalie presence. That's really key. And again, you're going to compete to establish, all right, your position right in front of the paint there. All right, you cannot go in the paint. We respect that. But right on top of the paint right there. Shoot pucks at the net when we have drivers and traffic. We don't want to throw pucks when there's no traffic. All right. We want example, we go low high to RD. The RDs have demanded to take the info before having the puck, obviously, but they won't throw a puck, a little muffin at the net when there's nobody in front. But as soon as we have traffic, let's go put it around. And beat your guy to net. You saw a couple sequences there that winning the race inside. That's exactly it. The push off, that's the one that I said when I said that maybe was a penalty for cross check. All right. But we took it, we scored. But normally you push more in the hips and it's really in tight. So you just push the guy. And you, like I said, you push the guy on the hip, not in the back, not in the numbers. That's a penalty, obviously. But at a young age, I teach that to the guys that I coach at Pee Wee Bantam. It's the push off. You push the hip, you create, you just need to destabilize the D there and you create your separation enough time to get the rebound or tip the puck and use your ass. In our offensive principle or system, we always say that we want to have two guys inside. So always two forwards inside the dots. So every clips you're going to see, we always have a minimum of two. But even if the puck is in the corner like this, see, we have two guys inside the dot. We don't go in the corner and having two guys in a corner unless it's a jam or we need a second quick. So here, 26, example 22 would engage a battle with 39. You get stuck. 26 is ready for the second quick. But until 22 has space to skate, 22 has to attack the space, and 26 has to be available for to create his 2-on-1. But also stay inside. So if we go low high, we already have presence at the net. Now we have nothing, we go behind the net. We go low high. See again, we have two guys inside. Two guys inside and they're gonna battle to get inside. So every clip you're gonna see, always two, a minimum of two forwards inside. Two guys, great screen. When we talk about taking their eyes, goalie's eyes, here, Keats, one of the best in the league, he's taking the eyes away. He's not at the net. He's goalie. That's goalie presence right there. You don't see the goalie right now. That's a perfect clip. For us, that's exactly what we mean. And when we teach the young guys coming in and Keats being a great ambassador for us, spent 5 years with the 67s. Now he's playing at UNB. That's exactly a clip that we show to our players. And again, you guys see two forwards inside and the third one's getting in for the rebounds. The other one, I will let them roll. It's always the same principles. Good second quick, retrieve the puck. And there's a lot of clips you're going to see, guys. We have guys inside. We force the opponent to come inside. We want to create those battle inside. And if there's a loose puck, often we're going to be first because we call that second actions. And every practices that we do, every drills we do in practice, we always work on our second action all the time, all the time. Let's say we do a flow drill and a guy come in along the wall. We don't stop at the net. We track the puck and we retrieve pucks. And if you think about it, guys, in a game, if you have an F1 carrying the puck and F2 driving the net, normally it's F2 will stop at the net and F1 will make his play let's say he shoots at the net. He's going to stay in motion and go at the puck. He won't stop at the net unless the puck is there. So in a drill practice, we teach our players to follow the puck. So if we shoot in the belly and the goalie stops it, obviously our player will stop at the net. But if the goalie deflects in the corner, boom, 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 five steps, get there, touch the puck, track your puck. Second action for the player. And now that's why we're first on puck in a game. So it's all about those habits that we teach on video that we apply during practice, but also during and after we apply during game, and we teach off video at a, of the game. We go low, high. Screen in front, but also want to come back and watch 22 behind. He's going to get in front and he's going to push off. Push, create a space. Didn't have any rebounds there, but he would have been ready for the rebound. We had a great screen. Good job. Attack the space. Create two-on-ones. Nothing. Puck at the net. We have two guys, two-on-one in front. Right there, score. But we had traffic at the net. You're going to tell me poor coverage? Absolutely. But if you look at a lot of goals scored, if you think defensively, there's poor coverage or mistakes. That's a game of mistakes. Hockey is a game of mistakes. So you want to create those mistakes. Battle. Go low, high, transfer, get inside. Get inside. Three guys inside, establish positioning in front. Take goalie's eyes away. Boom, rebound, free, score. The next one, the next few one are really important. And I hope you guys will have some question after, or if it's clear, great. That means that I did a great job, but I don't think I'm that good. So I'm sure you guys will have some question there. But when we talk about those details, that's where we feel that makes a difference between being a good team and an excellent team and being tough to play against. When we talk about layers defensively, you all been through that, guys, when you played or when you coach, that damn, it feels that the opponents are eight on the ice. That's exactly what we want to create. And if you think about Nick Nurse clip, that's exactly what he's talking about. And now the game of hockey, it's 5-on-5. It's not two defensemen and three forwards. It's five players playing offensively against five players playing defensively, just like the basketball. Basketball, they play five offensively. They have rotation at five, and they play five defensively. Same thing for us in hockey now. And that's why it's fun to play defense as a defenseman now, way more than maybe 15, 20 years ago, because back then it was only to defend. You have to defend, make the first pass, and stay behind and rest. Now you got to be engaged in every aspect of the game, which is fun to teach, but it's also fun to play. So be on top of the puck. Stop on loose pucks and in battles. Sprint back on top of the puck when we have the puck moves away, and also on a 50-50. As soon as you have a 50-50, some players will be 50-50 offensive side, and you know they're cheating offensively. But when you have a team that plays a 50-50 on the defensive side, like Marco Rossi and Jack Quinn, that's why you have success. And you look good because you have those key players, stud players that plays the game the right way. They are 50-50. They're going to be on the right side of the puck, on the defensive side, and that's how they create their offense. And young guys, they have to understand that. Come back, play at five, reload, get back on the right side of the puck, and you'll create way more offense that way. Stay on puck, be relentless. D, reload after your pass. That's part of the second action. I was giving you guys the example of after a shot in a drill. Every drill we do, D, he's making his pass, let's say, to the wing or center, because we want to use a metal ASCP. The tendency of a defenseman after moving his puck, he's going to rest. So he comes straight up and rest. My job is done. No way. Get back inside. Second action, get back inside. And we call that worst case scenario. So now you're ready. If the scenario is good, perfect, you're ready to join the rush and be on the attack. But let's say your teammate blows a tire. Okay. Or your forward make a turnover that which will happen. Okay. Because you got back inside, the game is slow for you because you're protecting the metal. Defensively, you want to protect the metal. You're well positioned. So you're well positioned offensively and you're well positioned defensively because you're engaged. So second action, So you, because you're ready to join the rush, you also, if there's no turnover, it means that now you're going to have a good gap defensively. So instead of being lazy behind and floating behind, and now, oh, turnover, I'm outside the dot with 20 feet behind. Now the offensive guy, we're going to take the middle, attack the space, and all those stuff that we're talking about. Watch all the guys. After a contact, you see a lot of habits there. Here we have a battle. We need a second quick. He's coming in. But as soon as we lose, we get back on top of the puck, and that's how we create a lot of offense, because we're tough to play against, because we have layers. Here, stop on puck, get back on top. Nobody floating behind. We have layers. If 17 gets beat, no problem. We have layers. We have numbers behind. And another thing I want to share with you, we won't talk about system tonight, but when we talk about our system, we always say that our system allows one mistake defensively. Why? Because we have layers. So if the first guy makes a mistake, let's say 17 get beat there, no problem, because we have layers. But if 27 cheats offensively and 17 get beat, now we're only three defensively. Huge difference. So our system allows one mistake, but not two. But if you think about your system, you always think about the fact that you won't always be perfect. So you need to allow one mistake. You got to be ready to live with that. And the other guys will take over. So let's say 17 gets beat. No problem. It's just like being on the PK. We have four guys back. No problem with that. Oops, sorry. Yeah. I got to let it roll. So pressure, come back on top. That's exactly what we mean. Being on the right side of the puck. Get back on top of the puck. Now we have the puck in the ozone play. Let's go play an offense. Let's have fun. Two guys inside, three guys inside. Always good habits. Whoop, battle, get back on top. Second quick. Everything's a chain connector. Whoop, here. We try to chip it. Doesn't happen. Stop on puck. 19, great reaction, stopping on puck. Get back on top. Tough to play against. If 19 goes for a big loop, it's a 2-on-2. And now whites have the puck in our zone. Totally different. Versus now, because we stop on puck, we have numbers, we go in transition to offense. That's how we create our offense. And that's what a young guy has to understand. For defensemen and forwards, they have to understand that. Here, we control the pace by jamming the puck. But see, we're all on the right side of the puck. Right there. Boom. All tight, working together. Nobody's flying by. Nobody's out of the zone. And now we're going, building our speed together. Let's go. Now we're going offense. Face off, lost, we're going. Boom, it create contact, reload. 11, reload D side. See, he's back in the play. He was right there. See, his stick is right there. He's back in the play. Great job. We place the puck. We protect the inside first. Always defensively, we want to protect the middle. So great angle from Grammer. Now, boom. He's coming back on top of the puck. Now 24 is going inside out. Protect the middle. Everything. Now, who got the puck now? 92. Shots on net, scoring chance. Who was the first forechecker? 92. He create his offense by good forechecking and then reloading on top of the puck. Right there. Watch that clip, guys. Always coming back on top. Urgency, relentless competitiveness. Second quick right there. We lost a second quick. That will happen. But back on top of the puck. Whoop, because we have layers, hit our pads, hit our shin pads. Second quick, lose the puck, no problem. Boom, reload on top. Now we're going again. That's wearing an opponent down. Good play from the red there. But still, they don't have any more energy because you have layers. And now, if we keep going, see in our zone, we still have numbers. Five guys back inside, protecting the metal first versus three reds. That's how you wear down your opponent. Got nothing, we place the puck, go on a forecheck. Inside first, second quick, didn't work, no problem. Reload, get back on top. Second quick, now we retrieve the puck, we create offense. Now we have the puck in offensive zone. It's not a matter of talent, it's a matter of willingness. It's a decision. You decide to work and compete. But us coaches, we have to give them tools. We have to acknowledge that, teach that, and that's how we evaluate them. And as a kid, how you evaluate yourself, sorry, it's with those things. And maybe you guys will have different one, by the way. This is ours, 67s, but you can have five of those and three different one. No problem. It's your own recipe. When I'm coaching young kids, I don't have 15 habits, winning habits. I have 6, 8 winning habits, and that's enough. But that's building. That's building on. You know what I mean? So that's important to know as well. We place the puck. The pressure will come from the inside. Again, we want to cut the middle. Stick is in front. Cut the inside. We keep them outside. Keep them outside. And after, who was on the forecheck? Number 9. Now he's back in the middle of your screen. And watch the effort. Competitiveness. Boom. They have to chip the puck because he's back. So now we retrieve the puck. Yes, in our zone. That's the chess game right there. No problem with that. But being relentless, competitiveness. Again, forecheck. We go. 22 finishes his check. Get back on top. Get back on top. Great job. 19 sealing the middle. We have numbers. 22 is back. Finishes bump again. We're 5 in the frame. Let's go and break out. But that's tough to play against. Ozone play. Second quick. We lost the second quick there. But now we're all back on top of the puck. 5 guys defensively on the right side of the puck. Like Nick Nurse said, you want to clog the defensive side. Tough to play against. You want to take the space away. That's how you take space away. And again, we won't be perfect all the time, but because you have numbers, everybody looks better, because if you make a little mistake, your partner is there to recover. Again, we came back on top. We stopped on puck. Great job. But we came back on top. We placed it behind the net because we had nothing. Let's go to work. And again, get back on top, allowing the D, because those forward are coming back, that allows the D to be aggressive. Because if he's not supported by F3, number 17, right here on top, that D cannot go there. But now, because they're reloading fast, they allowed our D to be active and applying good pressure and sustaining pressure and keep the puck in the offensive zone. And now we have the puck. We have the puck. We're having fun. I took that clip, guys, because Toronto, probably we have some Toronto fans here on the call. They're playing very well right now, to be honest with you. That's their winning habits. They're on details. They play hard. They compete. They compete. And I kept that clip because it's Marner Matthews and Joe Thornton, Jumbo Joe. Jumbo Joe is 53 years old now, but watch him and watch Matthews and Marner. Get back. They're getting back. See in the frame, 5 whites versus 3. That's tough to play against. That's tough to play against. And when your best player play like this, back in the days when the teams had more 2 offensive line and 2 defensive line, the quote was, if your top lines can play like your bottom, so your top 6 play like your bottom 6, and they compete like your bottom 6, you'll have a great team. Now that's a top 6. That's a top 3 in their team, or top 6. They play like a bottom 6. They're working hard. They're competing. They get back on top. They're protecting the medal. They're on the task. You have a good team that way. See, puck goes in, bouncing puck. No problem. We're 3 around surrounding the puck versus 1. No problem. And now guess what? We're going to go in offense. And now they're tired. They're going to go change. But now we still have the puck and attacking the space. Principle is there, is behind that is really there. So I thought that was a really good clip. Now angling and good stick. Obviously you guys know angling, all right? But for us, that's really key. Like you saw on the last couple of clips on the forecheck, sealing the middle, that it's really important. So again, finishing in front for us, a lot of angling, young kids, they skate towards the puck carrier, and after they stop and they go shoulder to shoulder, we got to make sure we get that shoulder in order to cut their ends. Cut their ends. That's really important. Get those hips in those ends, and you cut their routes, okay? And they cut them. You cut them off, and finish that bump at a higher level. Bantam a higher and higher. Finish that bump. Finish your check. Finish your bump. That's really important. You're gonna take the energy of your opponent out. It's not about killing the guy. It's about finishing your routes, finishing your bumps, taking his energy away, and that becomes tough to play against. And obviously the good stick, that's key. Stick on the ice. And to be honest with you, I watch a lot of game, Toronto, Montreal recently, they played against each other and I cut those games, and Montreal was doing a piss poor job on that with their stick. They always had their stick in the air. And that when you play against a good team or any teams at any level, if you don't have a good stick, they're going to kill you. They're going to kill you. Your stick, you need a long stick. We always call that a long stick, a good and long stick. Have a good and long stick all the time. Lead with your stick. Stick first, body second. So here are some clips. Good stick on the ice, cut the play. Good stick, lead with a stick, stick first, body second. On that, Vargy didn't take the body. We're going to give him that he pick up the puck, but normally you want to lead with a stick. And that's why I kept that clip. Great stick, but you can finish your bump as well. But here, good stick, we're in the ozone and we are attacking the space. Good stick, cut the play. Boom, it's in the back of the net because we had our stick on the ice. Again, right here, great stick. F3 here, becoming F1 on tracking. Good stick, deflect that puck. We have, see, get back on top of the puck again. Great habit, all right, but great stick allows us to stay in the offensive zone. If we don't have any stick on the ice there, it's an easy breakout for the Rangers. And that's what we have to sell to our players at any level. When we talk about good habits defensively, that's how you're going to create your offense. And that's how you're going to have fun. And that's how you push each other. Because when somebody doesn't do it, example, doesn't reload, his teammates know it. And coaches, you have to be not on him, but telling him to teach him to do it well in order to be a good teammate. All right. But also the competitiveness is there and he's going to play an offense. He's going to be rewarded with it. Again, good stick number 10. Good stick, deflect the puck. So we stop and we go chase again. But we're all back on top of the puck. As you can see, everything is a chain connector. Every time I add something, you see the previous things that we talk about. Seal the metal, good stick, good second quick. Finish our bump in the corner. We get the second quick there. We lost the possession after. Will happen. But again, track in. Get back on top. If I restart that clip, 25 was number one down low on the forecheck from the inside. Good stick, good second quick, 25 reloads. He doesn't snooze behind watching. No. Get back on top. Who's the first back? 25. We place the puck. We go on the forecheck. Good stick. Boom, we're waiting for our partners. We're in the change. That will happen, but great angle. Again, great angle. Finish our bump. Excellent. Give the puck, give the outside, not the middle, by a good stick. Watch 11. He's on top of your screen. He's going to reload. And having a good angle with a good stick and finish in front. Exactly what we meant. Get that shoulder in. At a younger level, it's touch the ends there. Don't get the bump, but get in that stick. Peewee and under, get in that stick. Get in that stick. Stick first, get in that stick, and you're cutting in there in front of him. You cannot go anywhere. Body contact, obviously shoulder right in front, and you take his energy out. Here, we call that squeeze for the D's. Watch number 12 in the middle there. That's an angling for the D's at our blue line. We call that squeeze. We're going to squeeze them there. No time, no space. Great angling. Good stick. You should have a stick down there. But again, finishing his bump. Second quick, we got the puck. Same principle here from 26. Great squeeze. We force them to chip. And again, break out. Surround the puck from number three. And if I let that clip go, you would see they would have wheel because he's attacking the space. Okay. Here, different angle, but 28 here. That's exactly what we mean, guys, by hip and stick. You need, I'll try to do a good job there. You need to have your stick in one lane and your hip in the other. So here, you see his stick is, he's a lefty, so he has his stick in his right hand. And the stick is on the right side of number 27. And you see his hip, his left hip is on the left side, all right, of 27. So that guy cannot go anywhere, or it's at least it's tougher. So if he goes on your stick, you can react and having a good stick on puck. And if he goes on your hip, you have a better body position. And if you look at Montreal's game, Romanov, that I like him a lot, but he struggles with that right now because the caliber is higher than it was playing, and the game is faster. And now when he goes in a do an angling down low, example, he's always having his stick and his hip in the same lane. So the players on the opponent, they always play with that. They bring him on one side and they turn back. So he cannot sustain pressure because he doesn't have a good stick and hip. So here, see, that's a finishing there, but that's a hip and stick. And you can do that, not that sequence, but you can work and teach the hip and stick at any level. You're going to see down low right there. It's coming. Boom. Good angle. Hip and stick. Good second quick retrieve. Here, again, good hip and stick. That allows us to trap him. Great second quick. And after, want to take the medal. Step inside. Good step from 27 inside. I'll play it again. Watch the hip and stick of 24. 24 is 5'6". All right. It's not a matter of size. It's a matter of technique and being strong on your edges and having the right technique, like I just mentioned. Stick on one side, hip on the other. Boom. Trap him. Finish your bump. And again, it's not about killing the guy. Finish your bump. By finishing his bump here, it took the energy out of the opponent. And now 24 has an edge. And now it's tough to play against because I don't see the number of the white guy there. All right. But now he's behind the play. We have an unmanned situation offensively. Tough to play against again. Finish your bump. Great hip and stick. Boom. Another one right here. Hip and stick. That should be a penalty, by the way, but second quick. But that year, it's a big game. It's against Oshawa. Less than in the third, just like the NHL. The ref don't call anything at the end of the game like this. And the players know that. Watch here, 88, great stick. Lead with the long stick. When we talk about ballers, 6'6", different stick than Joe at 5'6", but long stick again. But see, hip and stick. He covers a lot with his stick and hip there. Boom. You want to turn back? I got you. If you want to go on my stick, I'm one step inside and I'm regaining my position. No problem with that. Hip and stick. Puck goes away. Push him. Finish your bump. Just push him. Again, push him away. Push him away. You create a separation. And if we would keep the cup going, 88 would have come back, obviously, first to our slot because he pushed the guy out. Details, right habits. It's all about the right habits. Here again, hip and stick, bump, second quick. Next one, slow down opponent. Finish your bump, skate in their ice, take their stick away and play your 2-on-1. When we talk about slowing down opponent, here it's a soft lock angling. But I kept that clip there just about when you seal the medal, you're going to slow down your opponent. That's for sure. That's one. All right. And after, you're going to see some techniques, some good habits. But when we talk about sealing the medal, 23 peel back, okay, take that ice, but I won't give you the good ice. I won't give you the good ice at directing the play. So now, because 23 is doing a good job to direct the play, way easier for all the other guys to know what's going on the ice. Because we push a play on one side, we slow them down, allowing us to even the situation. At the beginning, it was a 4-on-3 for the Blacks, and right there, it's a 4-on-4. We slow them down because we control the pace, control the direction. This one here, playing our 2-on-1s. That's something I work a lot with our guys, and I work a lot with the young guys. Watch number 12. The reaction of number 12 at a young age, guys, you'll agree with me, all right, that he would go right away to the guy, to the puck carrier behind the net. And that would allow the pass in the slot, and now the F3 from the white would be all alone, and he would score. All right, and would blame the wingers, yes, but 12 has responsibility as well. Who's the most dangerous guy between the puck carrier and the non-carrier from the whites? I think it's F3, all right? The guy from behind the net won't score from there. So watch number 12 is going to buy time. When we talk about slowing the pace, all right, slowing them down, that's part of that. We put them on pause. We always say, put them on pause. Put them on pause, player 2-on-1. See, you put them on pause, allowing our winger to come back, and then I'm going to extend. But worst case scenario, see now 12 is expanding, because our winger is back. So we bought some time, we put them on pause. Instead of having a world junior player, number 26 from the Whites alone and probably would score, Tomasino, now we put them on pause, and now the puck is still at the goal line, and now we're going to attack him and pressuring him, and we're going to give that shot all night to our goalies. Watch in front, 27, stayed in coverage. If I go back, he's going to play his 2-on-1. He won't dive outside. That would have been easy to go at the puck here right there. He'll wait for the call. If the other guy doesn't call, because communication is one of our habits, as you're going to see, but he won't go right away. And he's a 16-year-old player learning. That's part here. He could have gone and expand a little bit faster. But that's okay. I'd rather him to be late on the puck carrier than giving the slot. Again, 26 playing his 2-on-1 right there. Doesn't bite on the puck carrier below the goal line. He's buying time. Slow them down. Slow them down. Here, good clip from Montreal on the PK. See the puck carrier. McDavid is behind the goal line. He's under the goal line. He just wanted to attract 44. Towards him and to create that seam play to Dreisaitl. But here, 44 won't bite. He'll play his 2-on-1. He put them on pause. Slow them down. And same thing with 26. He's taking 18 away and giving the short side to the goalie. It becomes a 3-on-3 right there with our goalie. And now it's all about competing, battling. Great job. When we talk about slowing down, we call that cutoff right here. All right, creating some interference, something we can teach at a young age. All right, here I don't like that 17 bring his arm outside. We don't want that. All right, but the principle that I want to teach there is to buy time to the D to recover the puck. And Wajadi is head on swivel right now. I love that. That's the third time he's watching. He's taking his information. All right, he's head on swivel. But the mindset is there. You're buying time. Now we can make a play. Watch here, number 10. He's looking to create some interference. You got to move. Move your feet. Buy time for the D. Slow them down. We call that cutoff. Here, 10 again. Cut him off. Take his energy, allowing our puck carrier to take it and leave with it. That's the split second you need. Just like here, boom, that's the split second that he needs to see the game in toe cap north. Here, buy time, boom, second quick, create 2-on-1, take the medal. Textbook. Create 2-on-1. Create 2-on-1. We're 200 feet away from our net in 2 seconds. Another one right here. 17 skates in his ice. Allow RD to retrieve that puck. Again, right here. Watch, it's early. And I love that clip. Watch 21 early on. As early as possible, guys. Skating his ice. Some people will say you're cheating, but if you don't try, all right, sometimes you might get cut, but you're helping your team big time. But like I said, you don't want get those, you want to keep those elbow down, all right? That's in the teaching. And from there, it's all about the caliber that we play versus teaching at a PWE level. Arms down, arms inside, just skate in his ice. That'll be perfect. Just by a split second to your teammates. Here we go. By some time, a lot of time, allowing RD to toe cap north. All right. Last clip of this year. Watch the face-off. Everybody's probably a lot of people saw that clip, McDavid against Weber. Montreal is on a forecheck. And now McDavid will get the puck right here. With speed, and he burns Weber. And the number eight there doesn't play his 2-on-1. If we play it again, when we talk about slowing the opponent down, Weber looked bad there because he didn't have the help of 24, his centerman. Centerman wins the draw, 24-0. All right. And Montreal dumps the puck in. So that means we're on the forecheck. We got to stay above, and you have probably the best player in the world right now. Playing against one of the top three, let's say, playing against you. So you got to stay above that guy. So exactly here. All right. He should be right on top of McDavid. Stay on top. Stay on top. Now what happens is on the O side. If he would have been on the defensive side, staying on top of McDavid, he would have cut him off right there. First of all, he couldn't receive the pass and he would have taken his energy out. Instead of that, he's giving him energy. And now Weber, boom, boom, you're looking bad, buddy. So when we talk about the fact that now it's a game of five, playing five guys defensively and five guys offensively, that's a great clip for that. That shows exactly what we mean by that. The box out, you guys saw that last week. And I think that I'll have to go through because I'm watching the time here and going pretty fast. So box out, stick under, win the net front war, okay? That's important. I'll show you two clips of that. We sprint the D's, cut time and space, and it's a battle in front. Take the stick away, early box out. Sprint the D's from the winger and watch the box out right here. Two guys in front boxing out. Now City sees the shot very clearly, and 27, our RDD, all right, is in far coverage. Excellent clip. Easy save for a goalie. Boom. We take that all night. Early box out. Lift the stick and push. The block shot. It's all about willingness, guys. All about willingness. In the first three clips, I put it in order. It's number 9, 22, and 23. Three of our leaders. All right. Two on our first line. And Quinner, who was playing in our second line, but who's our first liner as well. Watch, second effort, willingness. That's the pride right there. And the other one here, it's Markle paying the price. When your best player is doing that, you have a great team. Everybody follow behind. I have a bunch of them, but I'll go through. It's at the end of the day, it's a block shot, but it's part of our habit. The discipline, shift length. 40 seconds shift, stay focused, consistency, and stay composed. Again, discipline, you can define it the way you want. For us, that's the way on the ice, all right? And when we talk about shift length, 40 seconds, here Romanov and Kulak have been stuck on the ice. As you're gonna see on top of there, they're gonna show it. Shift length right there, 138 that they've been on the ice. I don't want to be picky on them or put them under, throw them under the bus, but it's only the fact that now it's 1 minute, 45 seconds. They're there, they're tired, they're exhausted. So what's going to happen? Here he gets burned. And here you're going to see right here, he's going to dive at the puck here for a split second. The game is fast. Now it's a split second right there. Doesn't place 2-on-1 scoring chance. Is it his fault? Yes and no. But when you've been there for 2 minutes, you don't have the same energy. And we always say to our players, tired players are dumb players. So now he's tired, he's straight legs. He's just exhausted. All right. So second period, sometimes tough to change, but that's why we want to keep our shift length under 40 seconds. And a little tip there for us, when there's a whistle after 18 seconds, often we will change. And if we don't change, it's a decision, because as a coach, you take decisions. Let's say they've been there for 20 seconds, but you're ready to live that they're going to go over 40 seconds then. But this is our trigger. 18 seconds, there's a whistle, it's a decision. Do we change or not? And just to give you an example here, we have that every game. That's a report that we have after every period that we watch. All right. So if you look here, that was a big game against Oshawa, a great team. And we had only two guys, if I remember well, over 40 seconds. That's the average right there of the game. But we received that after every period. And yeah, like you see on the left, the third period. But we had the shift length of every player's, the average at 5-on-5. So that was an outstanding game right there. All right. That we won 3-1, if I'm correct. But that's, we put emphasis on that. Short shift, fresh legs. We demand a lot. We want to play at a high pace, compete a lot. We need fresh legs all the time. And that's part of being a good teammate. Here against Niagara, our last game on March 10th, that we won 9-1. The first one I want to show you against a good team. And now it's against a bad team. You see the difference. If I remember well, I counted earlier today, but I think we had like 12 guys over 40 seconds that game. Is it way high? No, we don't have any guys in a minute, you know, but still, you see the focus. The focus during a big game versus a 9-1 game. A little bit different. They're still human, but it's all about being a good teammate. Respect your teammate. Communication, again, it's a decision. Help your teammate, be a good teammate by communicating. We always say your partner's eyes. So take that info for him. Defensively, battles, all that stuff, okay? And also on the bench, communicate a lot on the bench. What you saw, what can we do better? Next time, next shift, we're gonna do so. Couple example. I ripped those two earlier, but here, those two defensemen did a great job by communicating to Montreal's F1. Who got who? Bang. Yeah, Toronto had nothing on that one. Great communication. Here, watch number two is going to communicate to watch behind him to cover the slot. Now we expand. So nine is protecting the slot first. After they're going to go low high, now he's going to expand. But great communication from number two off at the beginning. Communication is key, guys. And we all know that communication is key. Watch here. Again, communication. And I'll finish my point after that one about communication. But communication, again, leads to offense. Now chip, create 2-on-1, negative space. We have the puck in the offensive side, at offensive zone. We say that the generation, they all have iPads and phones, and they don't communicate a lot. But us as a coach, if we don't put emphasis on that, they won't. All right. So we have to work at it every day. And don't get me wrong, it's not easy to make them communicate, but we got to value that. It's in our habits. We think that if we do communicate, we're going to be better than other teams. That's what we're selling to our players. But again, we're working at it in every drills, every practices. And again, we're far away from being perfect on that. I'm all done. Manage the puck. All right. Two more. Managing the puck. Again, it's a decision. Being a good teammate. When we talk about managing the puck, is knowing your option. bring the puck in the space. So the blue line decisions are key. All right. And if you have to hold on it as well, let's say I don't have any options, I'm going to eat it along the wall. Example, I'm a winger on a breakout. I have nothing. I'm going to eat it. I'm going to slow down the game, but I'm going to manage the game that way. Until we have the puck, we're in business. That's always what we say to our players. We have the puck, we're in business. Couple example. I kept that clip here. First of all, it's a different clip, but watch it. Quinner's coming off the bench. He feels that he cannot shoot it. He doesn't try to dig 74. He plays it for himself. That's managing the puck. That's a great play. That's a smart play. A lot of guys would have tried to dig there and they would have got back check after. Manage the puck, chip the puck. See, head on swivel, has no body because we're changing. He's going to hit that puck. You manage the puck. Allow our teammate to come in. Now he's in. We get the scoring chance because he's managed the puck. Same thing here. We're first. We don't have any support. We're on the change or something. I'm going to eat it. If you have the space, take it. But if you don't, eat it. Manage the puck. We control the game. And now we have the puck in the ozone play. Chip the puck. Transfer. Have nothing. Surround the puck. Eat the puck. Here we lost it. Gain the blue line. Chip the puck. We have nothing. We got to respect that the opponent doing a good job. Chip it out. Chip it out. Don't throw it. Make a play. Here we chip it out for our teammate. We have the puck in neutral zone. Here, chip, self-chip. Boom. We have the puck. Good rush. Here we have nothing. Self-chip. Boom. Win the race. Yet again, the hands in the glove there, and there's gloves. Boom, got the puck in the offensive zone. Got nothing. Place it, negative space. Let's go, win the race. Respect the game, manage the game. Create offense with that. Again, nothing, plays the puck. Negative space, let's go, go to work. We're first on the puck. Second quick. Chip, sorry for it. Here, we saw that clip earlier. Now it's a chip and go. Far blue line, we chip behind them and we go. We call that chip and go. Boom, win the race at the net, chip and go. Again, puck placement, smart puck placement to be first on the puck right there. Manage the game, didn't go through five sticks. Plays the puck in a free space. Same thing here, plays the puck behind. Boom. We got the puck. We're going to eat it in the ozone play. Nothing, eat it. Wait for your teammate to come in. I'm going to pass the other one. Change for the team. All right, that's key. Change for the team. Chain with possession. First guy on the ice, take the weak side away. That's key as well. Know the plan for a second and third guy who's going in. All right. Obviously, that's Major Junior. All right. Not applicable that much as when you're Adam or Pee-wee, but change for the team, absolutely. Change when we go north, not on the back check. You place the puck and change, let's go. If I'm coaching Pee-wee, it's when we go north, we call change up, let's go. All the three forwards, you come in back. Let's go, go to bench and we have fresh legs on the ice. Give you some example here. Playoff game, Dallas, 0-0. Scoring chance, they decide to change. Now it's going to be a 3-on-3 right there because Vegas changing as well. But the second wave, fourth man, will create 2-on-1s, create 2-on-1s, score. All because of the replay right there. You're going to see, watch Dallas bench. They went for a change. Now they're late on the play. It's a fine line between winning and losing. Here, two guys go change. All right. Allowing to Toronto. 2-1 game right there. Toronto just scored. Montreal goes for a change. When they go south, give a 3-on-2. The importance of change up, guys, is crucial. NHL level, major junior level, one goal is related to change up every time. Every game, sorry. Here, I kept that one. That'll be the last one I'll show for the changeup. Marner, all right. He's on the ice. Offensive zone, second period. He's going for a change. My time is done. Let's go. Let's be a good teammate. I'm going for a change. He's going for a change. Who's going to retrieve the puck? Good angle from 88. Cut the play. Great reloading from Tavares. Get back on top. They got the puck in the ozone. Now they wear down the opponent. Now Montreal are tired. The attack in the space, creating two-on-ones. Create two-on-ones. See Gallagher, how tired he is. And now what happens? The game is fair. Toronto scores because of a good change-up in the offensive zone. Great job. Just give you an example here of change-up at our level. C23, put in the break there. Sealing the weak side, allowing the other two guys to jump in. So now we have numbers. Who's there? 23 to create a three-on-three situation, and we have an odd-man situation defensively. If Marco would have go for a change, we would have changed the game. Maybe it's a three-on-two with a back checker. Totally different. Now we put them on pause because we changed for the team. And then we're going to chip it out, manage this. Now Marco is going for a change, and the other two guys will stay on the ice and complete the change. Face-off ready. All right. That's another habit that we have. Okay. That's the last one. When we talk about face-off ready, oops, sorry. Right there, Marner's ready. Ready to help your centerman. And that's something we have to teach at a young age. At a young age, is centerman, you win the draw. And winger, I'll wait for you to do the job. But it's a 50-50 battle there where the winger can help their center to look good. So here, Marner will help Matthews to look good. He's going to step inside, win his 50-50 right there. Bang, got the puck. Now Matthews won the draw because of Marner. So it started with a 50-50 that you can increase to 85% of the chances that you win because you have good wingers. And that apply for the defenseman as well in our D zone. All right, if you put a defenseman on the wall there, he has to be ready. Everybody has an assignment. Just like this one right here. That's a 50-50 and still a 50-50. RD goes in, win the battle. We got the puck. Oops, sorry, wrong way. And the last one here, again, teammates helping the center. 50-50, we kind of lose the draw here, but we have assignment to do. We win the 50-50, we help each other. We got the puck. So that's key as a team. Thank you very much, guys. That was longer than the previous one. I know that. But here's my email. If you want to reach out, don't hesitate. It's been a pleasure. And I'll take that out. But
awesome. That was really good, Mario. I really appreciate that. Lots of really
good there's a lot of stuff, that's for sure.
A lot of good information for our coaches to take. Yeah. But again, this will be on our YouTube page. So if there's anything that they want to see again, it'll be up tonight or tomorrow so that they can review it again. Lots of very, very good information. And I wasn't lying when I said save the best for last. That was really good. We do have some questions that came through.
Yep. Give me a second. Just give me a second here. Here we go. Now I got you guys.
You're good?
Yeah, I'm back with you.
Awesome. So the first one, what type of drill? So this is for the Adam level.
Yeah.
What type of drills would you use to teach second quick and puck support, etc.?
Repeat that, please, Jeff. About yep. a second quick?
Yeah. So at the Adam level, yep. What type of drills would you use to teach second quick and puck support?
Excellent question. And to be honest with you, simple is better. Everything we do, guys, is really, really simple. So what I'm going to say here, same thing we do with the 67s. Let's say we work on breakouts, all right, situation, and we work on our second quick. We're going to have a D, a forechecker, and a centerman. Simple as that. Starting example from the hash mark. Really in tight. Boom, lay the puck. D is going to eat the puck. Forechecker is going to go as a forecheck and try to pick up that puck. All right. But obviously the D won't let that happen. by eating the puck and center, go, stay D side, second quick, retrieve that puck. Simple as that. It's everything is simple. We isolate the situation and we work at it. So if you guys think about a situation on the forecheck, same thing, but work only on this, you know what I mean? In order to teach them. And then you go and you connect the dots by having a second layer, third layer, you know what I mean? In a transition example, by the example of breakouts there. Okay, second quick, when you retrieve the puck, we are on the breakout and then we go on the rush and we go take our shots, stuff like that. But at the beginning, no way. It's really in tight, really working on the right habits when to go second quick, because there's a fine line between the second quick and diving outside and having a double coverage. Let's say, example, we're playing on defense. My D1 goes and pressure the puck here in the corner and he create a stall second quick. But the mistake that we do is the D's going and go the puck carrier, but the puck here still have some space and the center goes as second quick. So now we're diving two guys at the puck carrier. And offensively, that's what you want to create, a double coverage. So that means somebody's available somewhere. So that's the things that we have to teach. When do you want your second quick? Is it when they're deep touch the opponent? Is it when we create a stall? That's up to you. You got to believe it and trust yourself. But simple drills like that.
So you basically break it down right to the individual and team tactics. So one-on-one, two-on-one, two-on-two, et cetera.
And bang on. Exactly, yeah. Jeff.
Awesome. So another one at the Adam level. What are your favorite habits at the Adam level?
Favorite habits?
Yeah.
Shift length. That's key. For me, when my son was at him and I would coach tomorrow, 30 seconds, because I know they're going to extend a little bit. All right. But having that in mind and emphasize on that and reward the guys that doing well on that are changing well at the right time and they're doing short shift. I reward them by double shifting them if I have to, you know what I mean? But just by talking and rewarding, everybody want to be on the right side. They all want the love of the coach. So they want to hear their name saying, oh, great job, Jack, come back after 30 seconds. That's a good team move right there. You're a great teammate. So you value that, that's for sure. In the list that we have, obviously, there's some that I would teach, but reload is something, coming back on top. If we think defensively, coming back on top, competing, because that's part of competing away from the puck. So that's good habits right there, because that mistake, or not a mistake because they don't know it, so it's not a mistake, but something that they have to learn quick is to work away from the puck, which they don't. We all agree that the puck carrier is working, try to deke, and the other guys are waiting. So reloading is key. The second quick, I talk about that all the time. Second quick, create two-on-ones, that's key offensively. So if we think about, I'll try to bring it another way. We talk about the four walls and there's only one puck. And like I say, we hear that a lot at the rink. That guy's a great player. Oh yeah, he's a great player. Why? He has great skills, great hands. Yeah, because he digged three times a guy in a game, that means that he's a great player? No, he has talent. That guy's talented, but he's not a great player yet. Marco Rossi is a great player because he knows when to deke, when to attack the space, when to create two-on-ones as a non-carrier because he works away from the puck and defensively, he works his nuts off. So he's great in the four roles. That's a great player. But a guy who's skilled three times a D during a game, maybe it's three highlights goal. Don't get me wrong. We'll remember that. But the seven other times that he got caught trying Deakin, that's not a great player. He's skilled and he's talented. We're going to work with him. Absolutely. Because it's teachable. It's learned. You can learn. But the definition of a good player, for me, that's essential. So that brings me to the habits and the four roles. Teach the four roles. Go with that, guys. teach the four roles. The non-carrier, create your two-on-ones. Work away from the puck. Your puck carrier always needs help. And defensively, you're the chaser, the guy to F1, you hunt hard. You're hunting hard. And or you're in coverage. Good stick, good coverage. So that's key for me. That's important.
Awesome. A couple more questions here. Just you kind of touched on it before, but do you also use smaller games in order to teach your habits?
All the time. That's the game right there, guys. When we talk about the four roles, you play two on two, two nets, let's say, because you have two goalies, or one net if you only have one goalie, no problem with that. But let's say we take a two on two game, that tactics right there. And you have your two on ones, you have the puck carrier attacking the space, protecting, creating his own space. The non-carrier creating seam, creating two on one, creating space for the teammates, for the puck carrier. And defensively, like I just mentioned, you have the checker, the guy who wants, and you have the other guy in coverage. So you have your four roles right there. So that's the hockey game. So, and the guys love it. The kids love it. They learn. But I see a lot of guys doing smaller games without any objectives. It's not only a fun drill. It's fun because we compete. We bring the compete level high because they want to play well. But we need to bring objectives, the right habits in those drills all the time, all the time. And you're going to see your team going like that way because they're going to learn. They're going to know what to do. They're going to detect situation because in a game because you work on smaller games and you work on those four roles.
Perfect. How many of the decisions or habits would you work on in a particular practice?
Hit them. A lot of them. That's a good question. Honestly, I don't have a sharp answer. That's a good question. I would have to think about it, but I think we work at almost everyone. Just to give you an anecdote here, two of them. First one, Team Canada, 2010. So at the Olympics, Babcock, first drill, change up. Working on change up. The importance of changing the right way at the right time. And who's going where when you jump on the ice. That's key. Because that's a transition right there where your opponent can take advantage of you if you're not good at it. Two, face off. Because it stands still, it's 50-50. We got to be good on face off. When I say face off, it's all not only winning the draw as a center, but also knowing what I have to do when we win or when we lose in every zone. That's, and the anecdote is, what was my anecdote? What was the question again?
It was about habits. How many habits do you work on at a practice?
Okay. I forgot the anecdotes. Anyways, it's not a big deal, but it might come back. But yeah, you work on your habits on the daily basis. We do, like I said, we do 80% of our video on habits every day. We teach that every day.
Every day and every drill.
Yeah. Oh yeah. That's our practice right there.
Yeah. Okay. So just a follow-up question on the question before. So can you clarify what are the four roles? So you talked about a small area game where you puck carrier and second quick, the four roles. Can you clarify?
Yes. In the hockey game or any collective sports, there's four roles. All right. So us hockey, there's two offensive roles. So when we have the puck, when our team have the puck in any zone. And just to help guys to understand that, take football, let's say. Football, you're at your 10 yards line. You have Tom Brady as a quarterback. You're in offense. Even if you're close to your zone, all right, you're in offense because you have the ball. Same thing in hockey. As soon as your team has the puck, we're in offense. And that's something that we have to clarify with some of the coaches. And so when we have the puck, there's two roles. The puck carrier himself and the other four guys on the ice are the non-carriers. So puck carriers obviously working at taking the space, all stuff that we talked about. But the non-carriers, they have to work at creating two-on-ones. And that's for the other four. Because if we think ozone play, we have an F1 in the corner. F2 near the net, like I showed you. He has to create his two-on-one. F3 in the slot, ready to shoot. He's creating his seam. He's creating his two-on-one with the puck carrier. And then when we talk about collective, it creates a triangle. We all agree with that. And same thing with the D1 on the strong side. He's creating his 2-on-1 with the puck carrier on the low high plate. That's creating his 2-on-1. And if you think about it, F1, D1, and F3, guess what? They create a triangle. So it's always that, creating 2-on-1s, and you fill up a spot that will create triangles on the ice. So that's offensive side. And on the defensive side, it's when our team doesn't have the puck. So anywhere on the ice, the offensive zone, neutral zone, and our D zone, we don't have the puck. We chase the puck carrier. We're on defense. So there's the checker. I don't know. Is it the hunter, F1? He's the guy who's hunting the puck. And we have four guys who are in coverage. So F1 dictate the play. He brings the play on one side with his angling. If you guys remember the clips that we saw, F1 for checking, he's from the middle, angling and directing the play towards the outside, allowing our F2, F3, and our Ds to be in coverage and react faster to our F1. That's team cohesion as well. Another level.
Awesome. We'll get you out of here on one last question. It's kind of something that Andre touched on as well. Do the players know if you're not yelling that you are pissed, since you are very vocal in games? And Andre kind of touched on it as well, in terms of not yelling at players, but more about knowing exactly what's expected of them.
Yeah. First of all, we're very vocal behind the bench. We have to admit that. But we try to help our players to, example, head up, watch, stuff like that. We yell that a lot. But yelling at a player, let's say, if I understand well the question, obviously, before we yell, we'll have to talk a couple of times, all right? And we always say we all like our players, all right? And there's a player and there's the person. We all love the person. I like you as a person, but right now, as a player, you piss me off. I'm pissed at the player right now. So, and it's just like with your kids. All right, take it with your family. If you're pissed at your kid and you voice a little bit, you raise the tone there, and you, when you talk, they still know that you love them. So you need to build that trust before. You need to build that relationship. You have a relationship with your kid, allowing you to tell your daughter or your son what you have to tell him. You're telling the truth. That's a tough love, we call. We call that a tough love, but it's for their benefits, all right? So it's same thing with our players. You got to create that relationship, that safe environment, that you care about the person and the player first, and then they know you're doing that for the right reasons. So at any level, you need to create that chemistry, that relationship. That's the human part of the situation right now, and that's the number one key. All right, create that relationship. And from there,